Hello and welcome to Halftime Report. Well, we're halfway through the trading session. It's a good time to run you through what's going on. It's a very, very volatile trading session. We have been in the green up more than 50 points odd, and we've been down more than 50 points as well. So in a wide range of spot, we're seeing for the time being a bit of consolidation. I'm Nigel D'Souza, and with me for the next 1 hour is Sonia Shenoy. Hey, Sonia.
Hi, Nigel. After the mayhem that we saw on Monday, today is not bad, right? Yeah. I mean, it's something that the bulls would have wanted to see all day. Of course, I take your point that it's completely all over the place for the market. But the good point is that this market has definitely picked up from the lows of trade. So at this point in time, all indices, Sensex, Nifty, even the Bank Nifty, up quite a bit. So in the next 1 hour, there could be more volatility perhaps.
Absolutely. First up though, let's run our viewers through all the top stories at the half hour mark. Volatile trade on Dalal Street, but largely in the green. The key indices inch up nearly around 0.5%. But the mid-cap index underperforms, trades in the red.
Yes Bank continues to rise on hopes of higher capital infusion, boosts the Nifty Bank, which is up 0.5%.
And crude prices crawl up on hopes of Russia joining the supply cut talks. BPCL is in focus after CNBC-TV18 learns that the government will continue with the LPG subsidy payment despite privatization.
All right, it's time now for our movers and shakers segment. Let's start straight with what's happening in the banking space. On to our Money Control exclusive now. Kotak Mahindra Bank has joined the race for acquiring fund-starved Lakshmi Vilas Bank. According to sources, Kotak Mahindra Bank recently submitted its proposal to the Reserve Bank of India. Money Control's Ashwin Mohan has the exclusive details. Ashwin, what are you picking up?
The race for south-based fund-starved Lakshmi Vilas Bank seems to be getting hotter with Kotak Mahindra Bank, we're given to understand from our sources, now entering the race and joining a few other strategic and private equity suitors who have already expressed their interest in Lakshmi Vilas Bank earlier. We're given to understand from our sources that Kotak Mahindra Bank is currently evaluating the acquisition of a majority stake in Lakshmi Vilas Bank. Now remember, this is a deal that is being carried out under the supervision of the Reserve Bank of India. Money Control was the first to report earlier that DBS Bank, Indostar Capital Finance and a few other funds were in fact in the race because the RBI felt that it was important to rescue Lakshmi Vilas Bank. Now, Lakshmi Vilas Bank has come earlier under the prompt corrective action plan of the Reserve Bank of India. It has faced liquidity challenges recently as part of its latest results. The losses seem to have reduced a little, but the biggest issue for this bank is the capital adequacy ratio, which is woefully low, far below the required 8 under the Basel norms. So that's the main reason why RBI is closely looking at this entire deal, and every proposal that is being submitted is being vetted by the RBI. Sources are telling us that Kotak Mahindra Bank has recently submitted a proposal for Lakshmi Vilas Bank to the RBI. And as far as strategic reasons are concerned, one of the main reasons is that Lakshmi Vilas Bank is mostly a south-based player. It has more than 570 odd branches, mainly in Tamil Nadu, but it's also present in 16 other states. So for any bank looking to acquire it, it immediately gets that bit of an edge when it comes to the southern presence. And perhaps that's what's in the eyes of Kotak Mahindra Bank. And mind you, the stock price of Lakshmi Vilas Bank has plummeted by more than 60% in the last 6 months. The market cap is also sub 500. So therefore, it's also a compelling value buy opportunity. As far as official responses are concerned, Kotak Mahindra Bank has declined to comment. We are yet to hear from Lakshmi Vilas Bank. Keep an eye out on this one. This is a big one being monitored by the RBI.
Absolutely, Ashwin. Thanks so much for joining in and filling us in with all those details. But from one bank, let's focus on the other. That's RBL Bank. Now, in fact, RBL Bank's Rajiv Ahuja clarified to CNBC-TV18 that the current capitalization is sufficient for the next 3 years. Also said that there is no exposure to Rana Kapoor or Yes Bank-related entities. Let's listen in to what RBL Bank had to tell us here earlier today.
We have not issued any AT1, as you mentioned rightly, that a very large part of our CAPAD is actually pure equity, which we raised, as you remember, 2,700 crores in December. This equity is good enough for the next 3 years of expansion and investment, as we've clarified. Our December commentary on our corporate credit cycle is pretty much what it is, that we've seen almost the last of it. We provided for whatever was identified. 80% was provided, and the balance will get done in this March. And we have enough growth momentum for the next several years. I think RBI has been very swift and clear. And I'm just, you know, repeating what I've read on your channel about the imminent resolution and a very strong resolution of Yes Bank. I don't think it's in anybody's interest to have this prolonged. Given a lot of these things are public, I can very confidently say we have nothing as exposure whatsoever.
All right, they have no exposure to Rana Kapoor or Yes Bank related entities, and they have no exposure to 81 bonds as well. The stock actually saw a big recovery post that clarification. But moving on, Aurobindo Pharma is also on our radar. Ekta is here to tell us why she's watching that one. Ekta, over to you.
Well, yes, Aurobindo is in focus because we've managed to access the Form 483 or the six observations which have been issued to their Unit 12. Now, remember that the Unit 12 is basically a formulations manufacturing facility for the US markets for Aurobindo, which manufactures antibiotics, oral solid dosages, injectables. It was inspected in the month of Feb and was issued six observations. Now, I've shown the observations to a couple of experts, and they believe that while there are no repeat observations and no data integrity, there might be a little bit of a timeline for Aurobindo to resolve these observations, and the response by Aurobindo would be critical in terms of determining the future course of action. In terms of the financial impact, Unit 12, according to analysts, in fact, does not have any sort of pending ANDAs or any filings which are under review when it comes to the US markets. But I think the market is concerned about the larger picture when it comes to Aurobindo in terms of the regulatory issues. So, for example, the latest being Unit 12 receiving six observations, but before this Unit 4, where the voluntary action indicated status was rescinded by the US FDA just in the span of around 2 to 3 days. Unit 7, which was classified as official action indicated, which increases the probability of a warning letter. Unit 11, which received a warning letter in July 2019. And Unit 1 and Unit 9, which both have official action indicated statuses, which are outstanding since May 2019. So I think despite the fact that the street could believe that these observations would probably be resolvable, financial impact is low, the larger picture would probably concern the street.
Well, thanks so much for that, Ekta. Let's get straight to CNBC-TV18 exclusive then. We learned from sources that the government will continue with the LPG subsidy payment despite BPCL likely to get privatized. Sapna Das joins us online to fill us in with all those details. Sapna.
So basically, this is an in-principle call that has been taken by the government. Of course, there'll be due clarifications that are likely, but clearly, you know, the supreme commitment of the government towards customers in terms of subsidy payments, that continues, that will continue despite, you know, BPCL changing hands in terms of government exiting its entire stake from the company. So that's one. Second, you know, with this kind of an with this kind of a call, or rather this kind of a policy stance, it's pretty much clear that, you know, potential bidders in BPCL, for BPCL, will have to, you know, factor this in, that the subsidy commitments to the customers by the government will continue. And the expectation is that possibly the Petroleum Ministry could, you know, issue a clarification at some point in time. We are not aware about the timing and, you know, how that's going to proceed. And just a last point, if further clarity is required, maybe, you know, the government at some point in time could also seek a cabinet note to give it a kind of a final stamp of clarity. But net, you know, all the subsidy commitments are going to continue. And we just need to wait and watch and see whether it's going to be a different mechanism or possibly the same mechanism, you know, will have to be honoured by the new player as well.
Okay, thanks a lot, Sapna, for that. So that's the latest on BPCL. But let's do a quick recap of the top buzzing stocks now. We have Lakshmi Vilas Bank, Kotak Mahindra Bank, RBL Bank, Aurobindo Pharma and BPCL as the stocks on our radar. But on to the latest on Jet Airways. The company has not received any bids just yet. Ritu Singh has all the details for us. Ritu, hi, what are you picking up?
Well, you know, this is the third round of bidding that the creditors of Jet Airways had conducted yet again. And, you know, not very surprising result is that none of the so-called interested suitors have now submitted a bid or an EOI. The expectation was that Prudent ARC and a Russian fund by the name of Far East Development could perhaps submit bids in the round, but they have failed to do so. Synergy has also been asking for exemptions and has time and again not submitted a bid. It is becoming amply clear that, there are no serious suitors that remain in the fray. Keeping that in mind, there is a committee of creditors meeting that has been called, which was intimated to the exchanges on the 12th of March, where a call will be taken on what to do as the next step forward. Liquidation seems to be a very real possibility, as we've been saying for a while. The 270-day period ends on the 15th of March. But as for some of the bankers that we've been speaking to, they could potentially look at extending it, although it is amply clear at this point of time that there is little they may receive in terms of an interest.
Okay, all right, Ritu. Thanks for joining in, filling us in on the latest with regard to JET. Let's move on then. We learned from sources that the Maharashtra government may request the BCCI to postpone IPL 2020. That's primarily owing to concerns around the spread of the coronavirus. Yes, Yash Jain joins in to fill us in with all those details. Yash, tell us, what's the latest?
Well, Nigel, of course, be it anyone in India, you, me, all of us wait for this particular year, time in the year around IPL, an event which is essentially known to attract numbers, in people in large numbers. What they're given to understand is that the Maharashtra government essentially is taking a meeting today of the top ministries, which include the health ministry, the industries ministry. The major point of discussion for this ministry is to contemplate on whether or not IPL this year can be postponed. This, of course, a point of discussion has come about after the advisories from the Prime Minister of India, from the Chief Minister of Maharashtra against large gatherings, be it in the form earlier in terms of Holi festival or now in the case of IPL. We are given to understand that the meeting is expected to start at 2 p.m. Where all ministries will put forth their inputs in terms of how IPL can be postponed, whether or not state of Maharashtra would be willing to really host IPL matches when it comes to different venues in the state or not. The meeting is expected to last for a couple of hours before we get any consensus in terms of the ministries. And as I mentioned, this meeting is essentially with respect to building a consensus amongst the ministries in the state itself, whether or not they would want the IPL to be postponed. Once a consensus is built amongst the ministries, a formal suggestion will be given to BCCI with respect to what the state feels in terms of the spread of coronavirus and how it can be impacted because of large gatherings on an event like IPL. But do remember, the final call rests with BCCI. Also, just one very important point, this meeting also comes in context with respect to certain comments made by the state health minister, who recently spoke to the media, and he essentially said that very big events can be postponed. Human life is always more valuable than events like IPL. And in the current context, he feels that IPL can be postponed, keeping a larger interest of public health in mind.
Very, very important information that you're giving us, Yash. Thanks a lot for that. Of course, if IPL gets postponed, it'll hit the advertising industry in a big way. But as we know, human life is more important than anything. And with the escalating cases of the coronavirus, especially in all of India now, it's crossed 60, the number of confirmed cases. So this is really a big issue now. So IPL could be postponed. It hasn't been announced just yet, but there's a meeting that will take place later today. Thanks, Yash, for that important story. Let's do one thing. Let's take a quick commercial break on that note. But on the other side, we'll get you an exclusive chat with Hugh Young of Aberdeen. Stay with us.
I was racing mountain bikes in the UK,